It's not often that what is arguably the show's weakest link gives you something to talk about, but that just goes to show how good The Owl House is. The Owl House, being a fantasy horror slice of life cartoon airing on Disney Channel, is one of my current hyperfixations. It's hilarious, visually creative, has a strong main cast, a great premise, and isn't obsessed with being the next Avatar like so many other children's shows in the modern era. This show is probably my new favorite modern cartoon, second only to Rise of the TMNT. Hashtag save Rise of the TMNT. The Owl House is notable for being as funny as it is refreshing. To date, it is remarkably absent of a lot of modern fanficky trends that plague a lot of cartoons today. Cerebus syndrome, overindulgence of lore in place of character work, redemption arcs for monstrous people, you know the whole spiel. It's honestly such a delight to have a cartoon that's focused on having fun over anything else. So delightful that I find myself in those rare instances where my objective view is clashing with my subjective view. Which, segue, leads us to Amity. Amity Blight is a recurring character in The Owl House, once minor antagonist turned supporting character and primary potential love interest for main character Luz Noceta. Personally, I love Amity. I love her design, I love her attitude, I love her gay panic moments when it's revealed that she has a crush on Luz, and I love her voice acting. Mae Whitman always kills it.
Oh, Luz, you're here! I mean, obviously you're here, this is school, and you go here now, with, me. I've been talking for too long.
So, subjectively, I love Amity. Objectively, however, she's more just kind of okay, which in a show that is absolutely amazing on all other fronts, makes her the weakest link by default. A weak link that is given a lot of exposure. So when we first meet her, Amity is set up as the typical school bully character and kinda sorta rival to Luz. She's condescending, she's mean-spirited, she's obsessed with being the best, and she's got a temper. This is accentuated by Amity slighting people that Luz grows to care for, like Willow and King, and how eager she is to sabotage Luz's dream in becoming a witch. Now, in any other show, this character archetype would be milked for at least 3 seasons. In The Owl House, however, it's a maximum of 2 episodes, 3 if you want to count her minor presence in Hootie's Moving Castle. After that, the show switches gears and has Luz trying to befriend Amity, despite the fact that Amity wants nothing to do with her at this point. Then Luz making sure they end up in the same classes together. Then Luz deciding to try and patch things up between Amity and Willow. And then the show setting Amity up to be Luz's love interest. So yeah, if there's one thing The Owl House is not interested in doing, it's wasting time. Compared to how long other cartoons tend to tediously drag out plot points, this show is practically speedrunning this shit. I mean, just look at how soon they chose to reveal the mystery behind Edith's curse. Oh, don't worry, we'll get to that next time. So the show makes it pretty clear early on that Amity is less a Draco Malfoy and more a Diana. That's good. It's a great deal easier to stomach than those other redemption stories we've been getting lately. So what's bad? Well, we can discuss the inherent toxicity of alpha bitch redemption stories like this that just teach girls to accept tone policing as a valid criticism, but there are far better examples for such a discussion. And hey, Amity is instead using her alpha bitch tendencies for good now, so we dodged that bullet.
You know, I used to be like you, Basha. Obsessed with status, challenging my competition, but I grew up. When will you?
Now, the innate problem here is that, just like the character itself, Amity's arc stands out as being just kind of okay. Where this becomes a problem is that all that development requires screen time that could have been more devoted to more interesting parts of the show. See, where The Owl House really shines is its main cast. Luz is an eccentric nerd whose obsession with fantasy and fandom tropes is taken to the most volatile degree, to the point where she ironically learns to become more grounded in the mystical and hellish Boiling Isles. Edith the Owl Lady, on top of being just the perfect woman, who makes my little gay heart go aflutter, is a proud individualist who juggles being an outlaw with managing her debilitating curse and taking care of Luz, who has been slowly but surely cementing a place in her heart to the point where she finds herself doing things she never would have dreamed of otherwise. King is a supposed king of all demons who goes from one harebrained scheme for power after another because of how unsatisfied he is with himself. Hell, even Hootie, while not having any compelling character work, gets the most laughs out of me than anyone else in the show.
Guys, today's my monthly cleaning, Hoot Hoot! I'm 20% mucus, but don't let that stop you! Come on, I have so many hard-to-reach spots that need swabbing! Hoot Hoot! Guess who found a special friend in the forest? It was me! Hey, guess what's been in my mouth that I'm about to throw up? The mail!
Hootie, where'd you go?
Hoot Hoot, if you want the answer that you seek, solve my riddle within a week! Ow! Okay, okay! She went to the forest towards Bonesboro! Sheesh!
This is a solid main cast and has enough supporting characters and regular antagonists to keep every episode fresh and satisfying. And it has enough overarching plot points like Luz learning more magic, the mystery behind Ida's curse, and the inevitability of Luz having to go back to the human world that keeps you interested in seeing how it all comes together. Alas, all those plot points and character work also have to share screen time with Amity, the one character who, out of everyone, is the most subdued and potentially dull. At this point, all we know about Amity as a person is that she was pressured by her parents to excel in life, which is what led her to be part of the prep bully clique that she actually hates. She likes the same book series as Luz, and she's easy to fluss. Again, nothing especially terrible, just something that would be better suited for a more grounded teen drama. After her bully rival angle is swiftly dismissed, there isn't much Amity brings to the table in terms of entertainment value besides awkwardness. Hell, her siblings Emira and Edric are more consistently entertaining. You could argue that a character like Amity is necessary to keep the tone in check, but the main cast is still perfectly capable of doing that. When the story needs to lay off the zaniness, Luz, Ida, and King are perfectly capable of having emotional and thought-provoking moments. If the show needed a straight man, or straight witch I guess, they could have just used Willow. She would serve the role perfectly fine. And yet Amity has still been given a great deal of screen time for all of her development. Almost half the season so far. The knock-on effect of all that screen time and development is that it comes to the detriment of others. Oh yeah, speaking of Willow, you know, Luz's first friend her own age in the Boiling Isles? You know how much development she's gotten? One episode, Hootie's Moving Castle, where we find out that Willow and Amity used to be friends before Amity cut her out. Willow wanted to do something to prove to Amity how much better off she is with her new friends, only to learn that she doesn't need to prove anything to anyone in order to be happy. It's a good little moment of character growth for the Hexside trio here, but it's the only one that Willow gets. You can make an argument for I Was a Teenage Abomination, but that was Willow's debut episode. It's more character establishment than development. Every other episode Willow is in just has her playing straight man to Luz or Gus, or being a vector for someone else's character development. Now, those of you who watch the show might ask, but Mikaila, what about Understanding Willow and Wing It Like Witches? Those episodes gave her development? And to that I say, look closer. Understanding Willow is an episode where a magical mishap causes Amity to erase Willow's memories. In their efforts to fix Willow's mind, we learn that Amity cuts Willow out of her life because her parents told her to, and Amity apologizes for it and vows not to let her old clique bully her again. In Wing It Like Witches, now primary bully character Basha starts harassing Willow, so Luz challenges her to a game of sports ball in her honor. Here we get Luz learning a lesson about not being so impulsive about decisions that affect the people she cares about, and we get a backstory for how Amity used to be the captain of the sports ball team before an impulsive decision hurts her teammates and she gave up the varsity jacket. Oh, also some more ship teasing for these two. Now, do you see what's happened? Willow is the central vehicle for both of these episodes, but Amity and Luz are the ones getting all the development. Willow's memory wipe is a plot device for the sake of Amity's development, and Basha picking on Willow is a plot device for Luz to learn a lesson. The most we learn about Willow in these two episodes is that she has two dads and her last name is Park. Keep in mind, this is Luz's first supposedly best friend since she came to the Boiling Isles. Even if you like all of these characters, you have to admit this is a little bit screwy. That's not even getting into the criminal lack of development Gus has gotten. Naturally, most people haven't even thought about this because they're too distracted by the ship baiting. Speaking of which, Lumity! Perhaps the most notable thing about Amity is how the show is clearly gearing towards her and Luz being a couple. This made itself especially clear after the episode Enchanting Gromfright. Here we suddenly see what all that screen time was gearing up to. Rivals to friends to lovers, just like one of Luz's fanfics, I bet.
Hey, there's more to life than shipping!
Don't you dare insult shipping in my presence!
A lot of people, including myself, have become considerably hooked on this ship because gotta get our sapphic-fueled serotonin somewhere, am I right? Sure, there are those who've been calling this a revolutionary step forward because in terms of LGBT rep, fans have the memories of goldfish. But that's more of a fandom problem than a show problem. The actual show problem for this is twofold. One is that Lumity as a ship is more predicated on the dynamic rather than the characters. What I mean by this is that the ship is less about Luz and Amity getting together, and more about their character archetypes getting together, even if anything about their actual character gets in the way of that. See, one joke the fandom likes to make is that Lumity is just Dana Terrace being bitter that Akko and Diana weren't the endgame in Little Witch Academia, and deciding to make it canon herself. That's clearly a joke, but it does kind of feel like the level of thought that went into this is sun lesbian and moon lesbian. This is actually bi, but don't worry about it. People who see these two together think they complement each other in the most adorable way and try to make it work. Trouble is, it's kind of questionable as to whether this will actually work, and it kind of runs anathema to one of the themes presented in the show. That being Luz needing to learn that life is not one of her escapist fantasies that rely on fandom trope. Now, Luz I can easily see falling for Amity, as she's the one who actively sought Amity's friendship in the first place and is already openly bi.
I've got a new crush, and her name is Education!
Where the show kind of stumbles is selling me on the idea that Amity is in fact the one crushing hard on Luz. See, since these two met, Luz has gotten Amity in trouble at school, humiliated her in front of a literal audience, invaded her privacy, stole her belongings, endangered her and her family more than once, and yet, we are intended to believe that it's Amity who is yearning for this disaster by. Kind of a lot of hurdles you're expecting us to leap, didn't he? I mean, sure, the fact that mortal peril is more common in the Boiling Isles makes a lot of this appear as not so bad in the greater context of the show, but the fact that a lot of these misdeeds come with a lesson that Luz needs to learn means that it can come across as Luz simply wearing Amity down rather than genuine feelings being developed. Now, some of you might be saying, well, if Dana was going to pair these two together, why did she have to include all that rivalry and redemption stuff? Why not just set them up as friends at the beginning and work from there? Well, remember, this is all predicated on the dynamic. They have to start off as rivals, warm up to each other and make peace as friends, and then harbor feelings for each other and become lovers. Their relationship has to fit a certain mold or the exercise is moot. If this is about Luz and Amity forming a natural relationship and not trying to get these two to fit an archetype, they would have started off as friends and then gotten together later. Or hell, maybe Luz would have ended up with Willow and Amity would just stay the bully character. But thanks to Dana growing up in a generation where enemies to lovers fanfics fucking dominated fandom culture, where protagonists are more often paired with their rivals than their best friends, this is what we get. And once again, I'll remind you that this show started off with a message that Luz couldn't rely on fantasy tropes to get through every problem, and that she has to learn to grow up a little. Trying to fit her and Amity into this mold runs in direct opposition to that message. Of course, this isn't the most egregious problem with Lumity. Far from it. As much as I gripe, we've gotten this trope crammed down our throats in far more sinister and toxic cases. The fact that its development has been more or less a speedrun eases a lot of the problems that would have otherwise presented themselves as it did with those previous cases. Plus, they're still just so dang cute. Look at them! Look at how so damn cute they are! Who needs to worry about logistics and execution when they're just so damn cute? No. The worst thing about this is a much older, much more insidious trope in terms of storytelling. Will they? Won't they? The absolute fucking nadir of romantic fiction. Writers constantly stringing their audiences along to keep consuming their content to see if the two characters will end up together. The trope that convinced people that stories about people getting together are far more interesting than stories about people staying together. The trope has plagued gay ships and straight ships alike, but is especially insidious when it comes to gay ships, because it means you don't have to write them actually being a couple until the very end, and still get truckloads of praise from the criminally uncritical. Legend of Korra did this, Adventure Time did this, She-Ra did this. Main characters ship teased ad nauseum until the very end and were all expected to just lap it up. This alone is what hangs over the head of Lumity, like a wrecking ball waiting to drop and crush our skulls. Because I will tell you this, everything I've griped about so far, from the imbalanced screen time to the clumsy execution and over-reliance on tropes, can be forgiven if, fucking if, we get a sizable amount of time where Luz and Amity get together and stay together. In truth, this doesn't seem like a massive hurdle to leap, especially with how the first season has been speedrunning everything so far. I mean, come on, how many shows about high school, or in this case, high school adjacent, have romances in them? How many times has Luz herself expressed interest in finding someone?
A chance to discover my true magical potential, and maybe meet a hot yet vulnerable upperclassman.
Of course, the fact that this ship is more predicated on a dynamic rather than the characters themselves is what gives me pause. We've already established that Amity is in no rush to confess her feelings to Luz, and Luz is more than capable of doing some destructive shit that can keep these two from getting together. Especially with Amity's dream of joining the Emperor's Coven, the sworn enemy of Luz's mentor Ida. If Dana wanted to, she could milk this ship teasing for as long as the show is guaranteed to air. We can very easily get another Korra or She-Ra or Adventure Time where they don't get together until the very last episode. And that isn't satisfying. And people know it's not satisfying. That's why people are already itching to see some payoff. Some people are saying, well, hang on, let things develop naturally and slowly. Of course, they don't seem to realize that we already get plenty of slow. All we get anymore is slow. And all that slow seems to guarantee is that these two will end up together at the very end. A slow-cooked meal isn't satisfying if you only get to look at the meal for a minute before it gets thrown out. Sure, I love Amity's gay panic moments and wing it like witches, but that's only gonna sink me for so long until I'm screaming at my screen, "Kiss her, you fool!" You can't tell me that Dana is worried about offending anyone with her work considering all the homophobes she's telling to fuck off on Twitter. Not to mention conservatives are already decrying the show as devil worship. We've long since crossed the event horizon of pissing off idiot homophobes. So the only reason Dana could have to prolong this whole thing is to tease the viewers, to keep the audience chasing the carrot on the stick for as long as she thinks she can get away with it. I'm hoping this isn't the case, considering how insistent the rest of the show is on not wasting time. But past experience has taught me not to be so brazenly optimistic. So what have we learned today? We learned that sometimes a cute face is all you need to salvage an otherwise bland character. And we learned that will they, won't they should be avoided at all costs. Sure, I might like Amity and I like the idea of her and Luz being together, but I'm also frightful that Dana will continuously and purposefully drag her feet on that front and ship teasing could threaten to dominate the entire show, taking focus away from Ida or King. Hopefully it doesn't, but until I'm provided with evidence that it won't, I'll remain guarded. Dana, I'm putting a lot of trust in you. I'm only extending that trust because everything else about this show is so damn good. You've even shown that you aren't fully willing to throw execs under the bus like so many people who get criticized for their lackluster LGBT rep. I'm willing to put some cautious faith in you. Don't screw me on this. Pretty please. Huh, well that kinda ended on a sour note. Tune in next time where I devote an entire video to talking about Ida. Surely that won't be depressing. Uh-oh.